Good morning and welcome to worship here at Northbrook United Methodist Church. My name is Alan Whitaker and I'm one of the staff here at the church. I just want to take this moment now to wish you all a happy St. Patrick's Day. As you get ready to go into worship, a few announcements to share with you all. This coming Wednesday is our Easter Festival and Egg Hunt. It will be from 5 to 7 p.m. There'll be more information in the midweek. The following week is Holy Week. In the midweek, you'll find more information about the different service times that we'll have here at the church. I want to encourage you to register your attendance with us and let us know that you are here. You can find that link in the email that went out this morning. But we would love to know that you're here with us in worship. Again, thank you for joining us here at Northbrook. And now, prepare your hearts for worship. Good morning and welcome to worship here at Northbrook United Methodist Church. My name is Alan Whitaker and I'm one of the staff here at the church. I just want to take this moment now to wish you all a happy St. Patrick's Day. As you get ready to go into worship, a few announcements to share with you all. This coming Wednesday is our Easter Festival and Egg Hunt. It will be from 5 to 7 p.m. There'll be more information in the midweek. The following week is Holy Week. In the midweek, you'll find more information about the different service times that we'll have here at the church. I want to encourage you to register your attendance with us and let us know that you are here. You can find that link in the email that went out this morning. But we would love to know that you're here with us in worship. Again, thank you for joining us here at Northbrook. And now, prepare your hearts for worship. morning and welcome to worship here at Northbrook United Methodist Church. My name is Alan Whitaker and I'm one of the staff here at the church. I just want to take this moment now to wish you all a happy St. Patrick's Day. As you get ready to go into worship, a few announcements to share with you all. This coming Wednesday is our Easter festival and egg hunt. It will be from 5 to 7 p.m. There'll be more information in the midweek. The following week is Holy Week. In the midweek, you'll find more information about the different service times that we'll have here at the church. I want to encourage you to register your attendance with us and let us know that you are here. You can find that link in the email that went out this morning. But we would love to know that you're here with us in worship. Again, thank you for joining us here at Northbrook. And now, prepare your hearts for worship.
My name is Brent Richardson. I am the coordinator for the Habitat for Humanity for Northbrook.
Good morning and welcome to worship here at Northbrook United Methodist Church. My name is Alan Whitaker and I'm one of the staff here at the church. I just want to take this moment now to wish you all a happy St. Patrick's Day. As you get ready to go into worship, a few announcements to share with you all. This coming Wednesday is our Easter festival and egg hunt. It will be from 5 to 7 p.m. There'll be more information in the midweek. The following week is Holy Week. In the midweek, you'll find more information about the different service times that we'll have here at the church. I want to encourage you to register your attendance with us and let us know that you are here. You can find that link in the email that went out this morning. But we would love to know that you're here with us in worship. Again, thank you for joining us here at Northbrook. And now, prepare your hearts for worship. morning and welcome to worship here at Northbrook United Methodist Church. My name is Alan Whitaker and I'm one of the staff here at the church. I just want to take this moment now to wish you all a happy St. Patrick's Day. As you get ready to go into worship, a few announcements to share with you all. This coming Wednesday is our Easter festival and egg hunt. It will be from 5 to 7 p.m. There'll be more information in the midweek. The following week is Holy Week. In the midweek, you'll find more information about the different service times that we'll have here at the church. I want to encourage you to register your attendance with us and let us know that you are here. You can find that link in the email that went out this morning. But we would love to know that you're here with us in worship. Again, thank you for joining us here at Northbrook. And now, prepare your hearts for worship. Good morning and welcome to worship here at Northbrook United Methodist Church. My name is Alan Whitaker and I'm one of the staff here at the church. I just want to take this moment now to wish you all a happy St. Patrick's Day. As you get ready to go into worship, a few announcements to share with you all. This coming Wednesday is our Easter festival and egg hunt. It will be from 5 to 7 p.m. There'll be more information in the midweek. The following week is Holy Week. In the midweek, you'll find more information about the different service times that we'll have here at the church. I want to encourage you to register your attendance with us and let us know that you are here. You can find that link in the email that went out this morning. But we would love to know that you're here with us in worship. Again, thank you for joining us here at Northbrook. And now, prepare your hearts for worship. habit of it. Hey, so welcome to worship this morning at Northbrook. My name is Alan Whitaker. I'm one of the staff here at the church. We're so glad that you guys have chosen to join us in person and online. Also, happy St. Patrick's Day. I see a lot of green. This is lovely. So I have a few announcements to share with you guys. So buckle up, and we're going to hit the ground running. This Wednesday, March 20th, we have our Easter Festival, which is one of my favorite times of the year, from 5 to 7 p.m. Bring your neighbors and enjoy the celebration, or even better yet, we would love to have you sign up to volunteer to help hide eggs. You can help serve food, or even help make smeeps, which is s'mores with peeps. That's all I'm going to say about that. Sign up using the link in your midweek email. Holy Week is coming soon, and when I say coming soon, it is literally 2 weeks from now. There's a lot of things coming up, and want to make you aware of all the different announcements that we have. First off, next Sunday is Palm Sunday. We'll have our regular services. We'll have the Brook in the Fellowship Hall at 9 a.m. and then traditional worship in here at 11. Monday, Thursday, which is on a Thursday, we will have a more modern, kinesthetic, active participation in worship service, which will be ending in a soup dinner. This service will be held in the Simmons Fellowship Hall. It'll be at 6:30 p.m. It will be very family-friendly and child-accessible. People of all ages will enjoy being around the table with other congregants. And if you would like to make a crock pot of soup to bring to our communal Monday, Thursday table, please contact Leslie Bowers for more information. And then Good Friday, which is on a Friday, we will have a tenebrae service with beautiful poetry, reflections, and music reflecting on the crucifixion and events leading up to it. That will be in here, and that will also be at 6:30. Really one of my favorite services we do here at the church. And then Easter Sunday on March 31st, 2 weeks from now, we will have a sunrise service at 7 a.m. out on the lawn. It'll be a little different. Yeah, sorry, don't come. We can come at 7:30. The sun will be rising. We will be finishing the service. It'll be right out here at the lawn. And then we'll have two identical services. This is a little different. We will not have a service in the fellowship hall on Easter. We will have two services at 9 and 11 in this space. The flowers today, beautiful flowers this morning, are given to the glory of God by Bill Holcomb, Betty Mullinex, and Jill and Mark Johnson in loving memory of our sweet Jan Holcomb. So now we ask that you would register your attendance. You'll see little cards that you can fill out. We love it when you do that. If you're worshiping at home, the link is in the YouTube description or on the worship website. And so now please prepare your hearts for worship. Thank you. Stand as you are able and join me for our call to worship, which is printed in your bulletin. Lift up your voice and call out to God. We cry out. Come together and wait for God. Surely God's presence is here with us now. Come, worship the Lord. If you'll please remain standing and join me in our opening hymn, My Hope is Built. This is found on page 368 of your United Methodist hymnal.
As we affirm our hope in our solid rock, affirm our hope in Christ, our Apostles' Creed together, it's in your bulletin and on number 881 in your hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory to the Father.
And now, if our children could please come forward, Miss Christy Merritt has a message for us.
Good morning. Good morning, guys. Jackson's feeling lucky, so is Harrison. Everybody's got your green on. So I'm so glad you're here this morning. Our story today takes place as Jesus is heading toward Jerusalem for the Passover. And Jesus knew from the time he spent in the desert with God what his work was to do. And that was to come close to people, especially people that other people didn't want to come close to. So he healed people, and he did miracles, and sometimes those happened on Sunday. Also, he was walking, as he was walking along the path, he would stop and get food for himself and the disciples who were with him. Sometimes on a Sunday, they would stop and pick grains along the side of the fields. The farmers weren't working on Sunday, neither were their workers. But the farmers left the grain along the road, especially for travelers and poor people that needed food so that they could stop and help themselves. So there were some religious people that saw Jesus doing these things, picking grain on the Sabbath and healing people on the Sabbath and changing their lives, and they were not happy about that. They thought he was breaking the law. But Jesus knew that God's laws were to help people and to show God's love to them. And he knew that it was what God wanted. And that's what God wants us to do too, to always be looking at ways that we can help others and always being kind and loving just like God to others. Will you help me pray and bow your heads? Dear God, help us to be faithful in following the teachings we find in your word, but also help us to follow the example of Jesus in loving and caring for others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, guys. I hope you have a great week. We'll see you back next Sunday for Palm Sunday.
We'll give the benediction here at Northbrook, and she'll say, go forth and serve. And one of my favorite things about this church is y'all go forth and serve. And so I'm excited today we get to just talk about some of what we do in mission. First, I'm going to invite up Jeff Olmsted and Gary McDonald from Murphy Harps are going to share how we serve with our Christmas tree proceeds. And then directly following as they're seated, we're going to see a video about what Northbrook does with Habitat for Humanity. So I'm going to turn it over to you. Thank you for being here.
Yeah, okay. No, there you go. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Jeff Olmsted. I'm part of the men's group that works on the Christmas trees. So this was our 20th year of doing Christmas tree sales. So just to raise show of hands, how many people have bought Christmas trees at any point in time in those 20 years? 20 years. Hopefully there's lots of hands that go up. Well, thank you all for doing that. It's been an amazing 20 years of this ministry. Over that 20 years, we have raised over close to $500,000, where we've presented funds to many organizations that support needy children's ministries around the North Georgia area. The last 15 years, we've been supporting Murphy Harpst. Murphy Harpst is an organization that supports those that are really less fortunate for us, kind of last chance children that are in the foster home system. And then the last 2 years, we've also worked with Project Transformation in terms of providing that. This year, if you haven't noticed the last couple of years, the quality of the Christmas trees may have gone down a little bit. The tree farm that we've been working with for the past 19 years or 20 years or so, they sold out a couple years ago to larger organizations. And I do want to thank Eric Poole, who may not be here at this service, but he spent some time of his own over the last week and went up to Boone, North Carolina. And we have a new supplier, the Klein Family Christmas Tree. And that farm is a family farm that was founded in 1974. And they have two distinctions. And I'm going to read directly off of their website here because it's actually pretty cool. So in 2023, so this past year, the National Christmas Tree Association, I was not aware that there was one, they selected the Klein Church Nursery as its 2023 Grand Champion Grower, and they provided the North Carolina Fraser Fir to be displayed in the Blue Room of the White House. And then in 2022, the previous year, they were selected as Reserve Champion, and they presented and provided a tree for the Vice President's residence. So if you can imagine, we're probably getting pretty good trees for this year and going forward. So please come and provide and purchase those trees because they do go for a great organization. And I'm going to pass it over to Gary to provide some information about Murphy Harvest.
Thank you, Jeff. And thank you, church, for your dedication to outreach and God's mission, including the mission at Murphy Harvest. And thanks to Eric and the team and who work so hard on the Christmas tree pieces. Murphy Harvest is celebrating its 100th year this year. Actually, this month. I don't know which day. I'll just pick today as the day. How about that? So 100 years ago today, a woman named Ethel Harvest, who had been sent to the area by the Methodist Women's Home Missioners Society, had opened a home for children. And for the last 100 years, along with the Sarah Murphy Home that started at the same time, serving the African-American community in west of Atlanta, had merged in the 1980s through the work of the Methodist Church to become the Murphy Harvest Children's Centers. We have a continuum of care that happens through Murphy Harvest: foster care, community homes, and then in Cedartown, in Polk County, we have a congregant care where we have kids who have arrived there. They're in custody, state custody. They arrive sometimes with just the clothes on their back or maybe some stuff in a trash bag to come to this home where we are able to offer a safe space, counseling, therapy, caring, moving them toward healing and flourishing. And the funds you have sustained us with over the last 15 years, both in the Christmas tree sales and your own personal gifts, as well as many of you have been to our campus and have worked on campus, is so appreciative and want you to know what kind of effect that has on kids. One thing that is unique about the work that Murphy Harvest does on our campus, where we have 60 kids, is our equine therapy. And a big issue that the kids are facing is an issue of trust. They have been hurt over and over and over again by people who are supposed to love them, right? And they don't know who to trust. And they get sent to this strange place in a strange town. And again, they don't know who to turn to. And often the first breathing creature that they turn to is a horse. I was talking to one of our equine therapists the other day and talking about, you know, how kids interact with the horses. And she told me about a story that they call horse breathing. I guess they could call it horse whispering, but that's already been taken by Hollywood. But horse breathing. And they encourage the kids early on in their work with the horses to talk to the horses. What's that? Oh, I thought I heard somebody. So they're encouraged to talk to the horses, to start to talk about the things that are bothering them, the things that they wouldn't tell any other living being. And they begin to talk to the horses, horse breathing. And often these little moments are the first places where the kids start to break open and start to trust again and start to build that resilience in order to move toward flourishing. And the support that you give The support that the Christmas trees give to us is critical to that continuing. So thank you very much for what you've done, what you do, and what we will continue to do together. Peace to you. Thank you.
My name is Brent Richardson. I am the coordinator for the Habitat for Humanity for Northbrook, and I'm here today to present this acknowledgement of our continued support for the Habitat Ministries. Habitat is a ministry that focuses on providing homes to the housing insecure. And as a part of that, its focus is a hand up rather than a hand out. And so the chosen family has to go through quite a bit of an educational process, and then they have to contribute their own time in support of other families' houses as well as their own. And as a part of that, Northbrook provides volunteers to support that building process. I got involved many years ago when I lived in North Carolina, just as a ministry of the local church that I attended there. That was Central United Methodist Church. My wife was also extremely involved, and she ultimately became one of the family selection participants, ultimately the family selection chair, and then she wrote the original business plan for the Restore, which is a commercial retail establishment that supports the Ministry of Habitat. And she went on to become the associate director of that particular Habitat chapter before her passing. I have not specifically counted, but I think this most recent house was number 48. So I've been involved in a few homes over time. Just seeing a homeowner for the first time get to take the keys and recognize that they have achieved home ownership and they have an asset that will provide them an ongoing opportunity for growth and for shelter for their family. Each time you see that, it's a very uplifting experience. Thank you for your continued support for Habitat for Humanity, North Central Georgia.
Grateful for everything you do to make sure that we go out into the world and make sure the church goes out there and doesn't just remain in here. So thank you so much for all you do. I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward as we prepare to give of our tithes and offerings this morning. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for all that which we have received from you, for this beautiful day, for an opportunity to worship you and to be with friends in faith. I pray, Lord, that these gifts that we give back to you would be blessed and sanctified and used to build your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Please remain standing and join me for the Psalter. It is Psalm 130, found on page 848 of your United Methodist hymnal. Depths, I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice.
Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications.
If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand?
But there is forgiveness for you.
I wait for the Lord. My soul waits. In the Lord's word, I hope. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, with the Lord is plenteous redemption.
And the Lord will redeem Israel from all iniquities. In my distress, I cry to the Lord, deliver me, O Lord.
You may be seated.
We'll now move into our time of prayer. You'll see our current prayer list is printed on the back of the bulletin. If you're at home, you can find it in the midweek that's sent out online. Our prayer focus this month is the confirmation class we have here at Northbrook. They are studying, they're preparing for confirmation on Sunday, March 24th. They'll be there. And so that's going to be an exciting day. That's going to be the 11 a.m. service. They'll be confirmed. If you are in need of prayer, do submit your request to northbrookumc.com/prayer. We do have Stephen ministers. They are here every Sunday in the prayer room. That's 201 in the B building. We're going to prepare our hearts. We're going to prepare our minds now for prayer. God of grace, God of compassion, God, we are gathered here today to be in your presence, God, that you will unite us in spirit and in purpose. As we follow Jesus from the grain fields to the synagogue, the shadow of the cross on the horizon, you remind us to rest so you can do your work of restoration and healing. God, may we rest in your presence and give rest to others so that as a community we can experience what it is to rest in you and to trust in you. For Lord, so often we rush past and shout down the sacred and we embrace the ignorance of sin, not comprehending the wonder and the joy you have in store for us. But, O Lord, there is forgiveness with you that you may be worshiped. Your light breaks through the darkness, illuminating our lives. You guide us through trial and uncertainty. God, in our moments of waiting, remind us that the night is no barrier to the morning light, that weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Lord Jesus, we worship you. You break down walls. You proclaim hope. You heal sickness. Strengthen us, O God, to be a community that lives out the gospel with courage, conviction, and compassion, sharing the good news of your love with all. Inspire us to action that goes beyond words as we seek to be your hands and feet in a world in need of your grace. As we wait for you, more than those who wait for the morning, fill us with your peace that surpasses understanding. Fill us with a joy that comes from deep within, a heavenly foretaste of what awaits us in your eternal kingdom. Lord, we offer our prayer today in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who binds us together in love and sends us forth to serve. And together we pray, as Christ taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Oh,
Would you please stand for the reading of the gospel? This is taken from Mark chapter 2, beginning with verse 23, and we will go into chapter 3, verse 6. One Sabbath, he was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, the disciples began to pluck heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need of food, and how he entered the house of God, and when Abiathar was high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat, and he gave some to his companions. Then he said to them, 'The Sabbath was made for humankind, not the humankind for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath.' Again, he entered the synagogue, and a man was there who had a withered hand, and they were watching him to see whether he would cure on the Sabbath, so that they could accuse him. And he said to the man who had a withered hand, 'Come forward.' Then he said to them, 'Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath, to save life or to kill?' But they were silent. He looked around at them with anger and was grieved at their hardness of heart and said to the man, 'Stretch out your hand.' And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out and immediately conspired with the Herodians against him on how to destroy him." This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Let us pray. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of my heart be acceptable to you as we engage in your holy word this morning. Amen. Well, happy St. Patrick's Day. Y'all look really green. If you were to look out on you'd see a lot of green. I wish that the liturgical color was green today, but we are staying faithful. So in honor of St. Patrick's Day, I'm going to ask you two questions. And if you get them right, I will not preach in an Irish accent. So, here's hoping. The first question is this. Why is there so much drinking and eating on St. Patrick's Day? He might have it right. It's a break from Lent. Out of the mouths of babes. Thank you. So it was a break from Lent. St. Patrick's Day was a celebration, so they stopped Lent. And because it was the season of Lent, they were particularly excited about the drink. All right, next question, and we will be saved from a very bad Irish accent. Why is the shamrock a good symbol for St. Patrick? The Trinity, good. That's what he used, allegedly, to teach about what the Holy Trinity was using. So good. We don't have to do that. So that's the end of our St. Patrick's Day celebration. But I did want to say to Margareta, that was a gorgeous piece that you shared with us today. Thank you for sharing your talent with us. I'm so grateful. We don't always know it's you because you play background so often for our background singers here. So, but thank you for sharing your gifts and talents with us. Okay, onward and upward. So we've been talking during the season of Lent about the work of the Sabbath in our lives, how God's creating the holy rhythm of life, working for 6 days and then resting on the seventh, working for 6 days, resting on the seventh. And it's a rhythm. It's a heartbeat that we're trying to adhere to. It's a sacred rhythm, and it's much more extensive than just rest. Its purpose is more powerful than just simply a day off. Sabbath is subversive. It is God's way of giving life and healing and restoration to those who have been oppressed. Sabbath is a pathway to freedom, period. These two stories that Jesus, they come early, really early in Mark's gospel, and they set a tone for how Jesus is going to work in relationship to the religious establishment. I love this story, both these stories, because like Sabbath itself, these stories are more extensive than just simply Jesus bumping up against Jewish law. They're more powerful than just simply Jesus rebuffing Jewish authorities. This is a story about Sabbath as a pathway to freedom. This is a story about Jesus as a pathway to freedom. So Jesus and his disciples are traveling through the fields, and they pick wheat. And I kind of always thought in my head, this was a little less about them eating and more about them being like a fourth grader walking down the hall and pulling stickers off the wall. So forgive me for my interpretation. But in the other two Gospels, they point out that they're hungry. And so Jesus and his disciples are traveling through, and the leaders, the religious authorities, are kind of lying in wait for him to do something wrong. We all know people like that. If you have a homeowners association, you might know a little bit about that. Or you may have a Facebook page in your neighborhood where there's always someone who's willing to point out who broke the laws. Is that just my neighborhood? Y'all have that too? This is a setup. They're waiting for him on the Sabbath to do something by breaking Sabbath law. And Mark tells the story so early because he wants to display quickly the inbreaking of God's power in a radical and new way. Those who are keepers of the law might have lost perspective a little on why the law existed in the first place. They are in their own form of captivity, so to speak. They've forgotten the life-giving and liberating nature of God at work in the Sabbath. But what's really going on, in my opinion, is more dangerous because they believe Jesus is a threat to their truth. Not just a threat to the Sabbath. He's a threat to everything they hold sacred and dear. And we know how the story plays itself out. The powers are going to be compelled at the end to put that threat on a cross. But I want to add here that the religious leaders are not all that different from us. They are not really concerned about the breaking of the law. They are concerned with the threat Jesus poses to their way of life, to the way they understand God. And no one likes to be challenged. No one wants to be told that their beliefs are not right, especially on ideas that they hold sacred. So for the religious leaders, these two stories are not just about the Sabbath, but they're about fear. They're about fear that this man, Jesus, is upending their way of life. And Jesus is a huge threat to what they hold sacred, which is an important place to start as we prepare ourselves for next week. Jesus, who knows exactly what they are doing, has compassion for them. I've always thought he was being kind of smarty, but I think he's actually trying to show them a better way. He has a heart of compassion. He uses this moment to invite them to see that the law is a pathway to freedom rather than a pathway to confinement. He uses this moment to show them that he himself is a pathway to God's intended liberation that has been celebrated through the Israelites crossing the Red Sea. Jesus is announcing a new kingdom, a new era, and a new way of life, and we know he's doing that because he tells this wonderful story about David. He tells a story about David, and either Jesus got it wrong or Mark got it wrong in reporting, because the priest, whose name I cannot pronounce, is actually not the priest that's in the story. Isn't that interesting? Food for thought. He tells a story about David, their beloved king of the Jews. And before he was the king, there was Saul. But Saul had gone down a bad path, let's just say, and was being replaced by David. The old was being replaced by the new. David had been called by God, anointed by God, to lead the Hebrew people, the Jewish people. The crown, according to God himself, was ready to be moved from Saul's head to David's. It was an inbreaking of a new era in this story that Jesus quotes. But Saul, the old era, wanted to destroy David, so David was fleeing without food to nourish himself. So while he is fleeing, he eats the bread that was meant just for priests. He breaks the law in order to retain some sustenance, to continue the journey, to be what God created him to be, which was king. Jesus was brilliant. The old ways are always threatened by the inbreaking of the new ways, which is why right before this story, he says this: "No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth onto old cloaks. Otherwise, the patch pulls away from it, the new one from the old, and worse, tear is made. Similarly, no one puts new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is lost, and so are the skins. But one puts new wine into new wineskins. That's what Mark reports right before he tells the story. Brilliant Jesus tells a story with two messages layered within one another. First of all, on the surface, the story is simply about David eating bread and breaking the law, showing the Pharisees, the Jewish leaders, that in fact, even their beloved King David broke the law in order to have life, in order to eat. But even more extensive than that, David was a threat to the existing power structure of Saul. Even though he was ordained and anointed by God, he was a threat, and Saul wanted him dead. Jesus is reminding them, and Jesus is reminding us, that the inbreaking of God's kingdom will always feel like a threat to those who benefit from existing power structures. What liberates God's people will inevitably threaten those who benefit from them being held captive. That is what Jesus is trying to say. What liberates God's people will inevitably be threatened, and it will threaten those who benefit from them being captive. We talk about the Sabbath as simply being a nice little day of rest. Maybe, you know, put away the computer for a little while. We think it might be just a day to say no to soccer practice on Sundays, or not answering emails, or make sure you don't cook. But we might just be underestimating the real power that can be unleashed with those of us who are held captive by the standards of the culture to do more and to make more, are set free to be defined not by what we produce, but rather by the one who produced us. When we embrace life as God intended it, bumping up against cultural norms and the powers of the world that benefit from our enslavement, we too will be seen as a threat. We too will be part of the inbreaking of the new era. Next week is Palm Sunday, and it is a powerful day that we see the King of our hearts, the one we glorify, ride into the city on a lowly donkey as people act like they want such a king. We will shout hallelujah. We will sing all glory, laud, and honor to thy Redeemer King. We too will say hail to the Lord's anointed. It is the day that visually should remind us that God, the God we serve, is not power by the world's standards. God's power is not found in more money, more production, greater assets, higher dividends, or anything at all that we find in this culture that tells us what is success. Our King is breaking into our hearts and into a world by setting us free from the lie, breaking us out, unhinging what has entrapped us, the lie that our value lies in what we can produce and not by who produced us. I am still struggling with what it means to pause and to trust God. I just got to admit that. I'm going to admit that to you every day, and you'll get tired of hearing it. Say, I hope she gets over that. I'm still trying to figure out how to be a Sabbath community, how to lead a Sabbath community in a culture that makes it really, really hard, with habits long formed in my life and within the life of the church. Which is why Mark, as well as Matthew and Luke, follows the story of the disciples and the wheat on the Sabbath with the story of a man being healed in the synagogue on the Sabbath. When we turn to the second story, which is always told in tandem, Jesus enters the holy place of the synagogue, and he sees a man with a withered hand. And now the Pharisees are super excited. Will he heal him on the Sabbath, trying to trap him? But he again teaches them about the new era, the new wine for the new wineskins, which is about restoration of our souls and the promise of new life. Jesus offers us a way out of the chaos in which we live and that which impedes us from being truly alive. The Sabbath is about healing and restoration, about touching that part of us that prevents us from being all we can be in the world. The man with the withered hand was healed on the Sabbath so that he could return to work the next day. The man with the withered hand was healed on the Sabbath so that he could return to his life of working and producing and being everything that he was created to be, to fully contribute and to support his family. The Sabbath is not just about the Sabbath, a day of rest. The Sabbath is about offering us healing and renewal so that we can return to the work to which we have been called, so that we can live the purpose, like David, that God intended for us to be. I think about that beautiful story of the horses and our children at Murphy Harps and all the people that we work to build houses for Habitat for Humanity. We do those things so that they might be healed and restored and return to the community and contribute and to support their families and to be all that God created them to be. That is Sabbath for us. So my question for us, as we go into preparing for Palm Sunday next week, is whether we're going to be new wineskins or old wineskins. Because the wine won't make it in the old wineskins. We have to be made new to hold the gospel. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we truly do want to be made new. We want to be healed in the deep, dark places of our souls that need it. And we want to be restored. So we pray, oh God, that we would truly be a Sabbath community that reflects rest and hope and reminds us of who we are, because we got a lot of work to do in the world. And you were preparing us to do just that. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. We are going to sing a song that's probably going to make me cry. Oh, good. Let's stay. We're going to sing Be Still My Soul, which is hymn number 534. If this is a day that you would like to renew your faith or you'd like to come to the altar and simply pray as we sing together, know the altar is always open for you. Let's stand and sing together. the Sabbath is not sad. I just wanted to clarify that. So, but it's just a special day as we celebrate and honor Jan Holcomb's life, which always gets me so. Go in peace and love one another and be the people God created you to be and make sure you rest so you can do it. Amen.